Let's say something. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
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 This is a verse from the 9th chapter of Bhagavad-Gita, 14:14. As Krishna speaks about the glories of chanting his glories, the importance of and the glories of chanting the glories of the Lord. I'm sure you could all follow along. This verse is quite easy in the Sanskrit. Satatam
kirtayanto mum
yatantas
cha
yadavitaha namas namas yantas chamam bhakya nitya yukta upasate
upasate.
Satatam kirtayanto mam.
Satatam kirtayanto mam.
Yatantas cha driha vritaha.
Yatantas cha driha vritaha.
Namas yantas cha mam bhaktya.
Namas yantas cha mam bhaktya.
Nitya yukta upasate.
Nitya yukta upasate.
Satatam. Always.
Always.
Kirtayanta.
Kirtayanta.
Chanting.
Chanting.
Mam.
Mam.
About me.
About me.
Satatam.
Satatam.
Fully endeavoring.
Fully endeavoring.
Cha.
Cha.
Also.
Also.
Dhrida vrataha.
Dhrida vrataha.
With determination.
With determination.
Namasyanta.
Namasyanta.
Offering obeisances.
Offering obeisances.
Cha.
Cha.
And.
Mom.
Mom. Me.
Me.
Bhaktya.
Bhaktya.
In devotion.
In devotion.
Nitya yukta.
Nitya yukta.
Perpetually engaged.
Perpetually engaged.
Upasate.
Upasate.
Worship.
Worship.
So Krishna speaks. 9:14. Chapter 9, verse 9:14. Always chanting my glories, endeavoring with great determination, bowing down before me, these great souls perpetually worship me with devotion. Please repeat, always chanting my glories.
Always chanting my glories.
Endeavoring with great determination.
Endeavoring with great determination.
Bowing down before me.
Bowing down before me.
These great souls.
These great souls.
Perpetually worship me with devotion.
Perpetually worship me with devotion.
Purport by Srila Prabhupada. The Mahatma, that is a great soul, cannot be matched, manufactured by rubbing, stamping, an ordinary man. His symptoms are described here. A Mahatma is always engaged in chanting the glories of the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, the Personality of Godhead. He has no other business. He is always engaged in glorifying the Lord. In other words, he is not an impersonalist. When the question of glorification is there, one has to glorify the Supreme Lord, praising His holy name, His eternal form, His transcendental qualities, and His uncommon pastimes. One has to glorify all these things. Therefore, a Mahatma is attached to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One is attached to the impersonal feature of the Supreme Lord, the Brahma-jyoti, is not described as a Mahatma in the Bhagavad-Gita. Is described in a different way in the next verse. The Mahatma is always engaged in different activities of devotional service, as described in Srimad Bhagavatam, hearing and chanting about Vishnu, not about a demigod or an ordinary human being. That is devotion, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu, and Smaranam, remembering him. Such a Mahatma has firm determination to achieve the ultimate end, the association of the Supreme Lord, in any one of the five transcendental rasas. To achieve that success, he engages all activities, mental, bodily, and vocal, everything in the service of the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna. That is called full Krishna consciousness. In devotional service, there are certain activities which are called determined, such as fasting on certain days, like the 11th day of the moon, Ekadasi, and on the appearance day of the Lord. All these rules and regulations are offered by the great acharyas for those who are actually interested in getting admission into the association of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in the transcendental world. Mahatma, great souls, strictly observe all these rules and regulations, and therefore they are sure to achieve the desired result. As described in the second verse of this chapter, not only is this devotional service easy, but it can be performed in a happy mood. One does not need to undergo any severe penance and austerities. He can live his life in devotional service, guided by an expert spiritual master, in any position, either as a householder, sannyasi, or brahmachari, in any position, anywhere in the world, he can perform this devotional service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and thus become actually Mahatma, a great soul. Om Akyan, Tiram Nasyan, Kyan, Janao Sala, Chaksi, Indiritam, Vakena, Tasman, Shri Guru, Vena, Mahatma, Shri Chaitanya Mahavishnam Sahibhanya Yanyanute Swayam Rupa Yam Mayam Dhyati Sahabhatikam Shri Krishna Chaitanya Mahavishnamana Shri Shvaitya Harshvasa Vipurva Pani Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So the word Mahatma, great soul, is given complete clarification by Sri Krishna himself, and Srila Prabhupada expands on that point. A great soul is one who is always glorifying the Lord. And Prabhupada makes it. Clear, there's no other activity needed, or no other activity desired. To glorify the Lord is not something that we just do, it's something that we make the goal. Because the Lord is the only glorifiable personality in existence. Anything else that is glorifiable gets its power from the Lord. So one who glorifies others without glorifying the Lord doesn't actually glorify anyone, because we have to understand the relationship between anything that is wonderful is also coming from the Lord. And Prahlad Maharaj was questioned by his father, the big great demon, Narada Kashyapu, where do you get your power from? Narada Kashyapu was quite powerful. So powerful he could overcome what we say. Many ways of not to die. And his power was so extended throughout the universe that the entire cadre of demigods were fearful of Narada Kashyapu. So, thinking that he had achieved such great power and position, and seeing how his little son also was also quite powerful, he became somewhat puzzled. So he asked, where do you get your power from? And Prahlad Maharaj very directly says, I get my power from the same place anybody, everyone gets their power from, including you. Krishna. Of course, that was the last thing he wanted to hear. Because he was thinking, my power is my power. And so, therefore, glorification of the Lord is the, what we say, the activities of the human beings in society. And that glorification begins with chanting the holy names of the Lord. Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So chanting the holy names of the Lord is a mantra for purification. It's a mantra to free ourselves from material difficulties and distress. There's so many, what we say, benefits from chanting. But the essence of the chanting of the whole name is that it is the best way to glorify God. There are many ways to glorify the Lord, and many ways that our Vishvashtras also encourage in so many different ways, such as worshiping the Lord in his deity form, performing various festivals and honoring the Lord, and chanting various types of mantras and glorification of the Lord. But all these things become secondary at best when the chanting of the holy name, Hare Krishna, or mantra is there. So in this age, in Kali Kale Nama Rupa Krishna Devata, Nama Hoite Hanisa, which is God Mystery, in this age that the chanting of the holy names of the Lord is an incarnation of the Lord to personally purify the world and to elevate the consciousness to pure Bhakti Krishna. One time, one person who was quite expert on the Bhagavad-Gita, he wasn't a devotee, but he had studied the Gita quite, and he had some scholarship. And so he challenged Srila Prabhupada. When Prabhupada was talking about how important it is and how it is the foundation for the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita to glorify Krishna by chanting the holy names. So Prabhupada was challenged, where in the Bhagavad Gita does it say you have to chant Hare Krishna? So Prabhupada picked this verse. This verse here, always chanting my glories. And so, according to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is Krishna himself, Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Radha, Krishna, Vahi, Anya, Radha and Krishna become one. And Mahaprabhu, he demonstrated and also taught the process of purification, as they can chant the holy names of the Lord. But what is the nature of that chanting? It is a focus and not simply an activity. In other words, and you can find it throughout the Shastras, that one should make the chanting of the holy name of the Lord one's continuous activity. Prabhupada said 16 rounds. 16 rounds is just to get you started. In other words, there has to be some numerical round in order to, what we say, access a taste. And the numerical vow keeps us chaste in our practice of Krishna consciousness, allows us to establish an attachment. But that attachment, once established, should continue to chant as much as possible, 24 hours a day. There are innumerable quotes in the Shastras, not just for a few, that one should chant always. And here, this is a quality of the great soul. He's always chanting the glories of the Lord. And so, in our Krishna conscious society, we put a lot of emphasis, time, and energy in glorifying the Lord by chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Goloka Prayamadam Harinam Sankirtan. But this Harinam Sankirtan is not simply something that is recommended in the Vedas. Iti soda sakam nam nam kali kali kam sanasana nam nata padatiyo padyo sarva vedashu drishyate. And then the second half of the verse is Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Srila Kali Santara Upanishads. And Brahma speaks this verse and he says that after searching through all day, the Vedas are vast and has various aspects to different types of worship and for different types of people. But culminating in the essence of all Vedic knowledge, he says that the best and most direct and highly recommended process, Vedashi, iti sodasakam kama, iti sodasakam nara kali kamasa. So in this age of Kali, especially, is highly recommended that this is the process for purification of the Lord, for the heart, and the best way to glorify the Lord. We can do so many things. We can offer puja, we can offer prayers, we can offer our time, energy, resources, and we can do so many things. But if we're not developing attraction for Krishna's holy name, these other things don't have much really noise, because all these other things are meant to bring us closer and closer to chanting of Hare Krishna. Why does it say that the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Maha Mantra is all that needed in this age? And yet, there is Srimad Bhagavatam, there is worship, but all these are part of our process of purification and worship. So why is these things there? In order for us to purify our hearts more and more, so we can develop a taste for chanting Hare Krishna. It's all about the holy names of the Lord. This is the essence, and this is actually the goal of life. I remember this one verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, spoken by Sri Prahlad Maharaj. He's speaking to his father, and he's describing and mentioning the nine processes of devotional service: Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Parasaram, Arjanam, Bandhanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atman, Vivedam, nine processes of bhakti. And so, in that particular purport, which is the longest purport in the Srimad Bhagavatam, about 14 pages, if you're interested in the verse, it's 7, 5, 23, 24, two verses. And in that, it mentions that, you know, the nine processes of devotional service, any one of them can bring one to the perfectional stage. Practicing hearing about Krishna is perfected by Pariksha Maharaj. Chanting the glories of the Lord is perfected by the Sukadeva Goswami. Remembering the Lord is perfected by Prahlad Maharaj. Offering prayers were perfected by Akura. Worship was by Preeti, King Preeti. Serving the lotus feet was Lakshmi. Serving, carrying out orders, instructions, Sakyam was by Hanuman. Arjuna with friendship, Mali Maharaj surrendering everything. Which one did I remember? That was surrendering and oh, worship? Okay. So I think I mentioned all of them. Each of those are mentioned, and each one has a personality that's mentioned in the Shastras as who outstanding perspective that. So in that, it mentions that each of the nine processes, any one of them can qualify you for perfection. But Prabhupada, in his purport, emphasizes the chanting of the holy name, and he says, the chanting of the holy name must accompany all of the eight processes. Otherwise, one will not get the benefit of whatever process one focuses on, unless they keep the holy name foremost. I remember I was in Germany many, many years ago, at the beginning of the century, and the temple president there, very nice to work with, he called me in and he said he wanted to discuss something. And so we talked, and he said, I have this problem, Maharaj. I got this wonderful pujari. She loves to worship the deity. She comes early, decorates the altar. She's enthusiastic, very good pujari. Loves her service, is very good at her service, except she doesn't chant. And when I encourage her to chant, she says, well, each of the processes are equally good, and therefore I am focusing on, you know, Archana. So what am I supposed to tell her? So I said, well, and then I mentioned this verse, where Prabhupada mentions the nine processes, but says, it qualifies that, by explaining it also, that the importance of all these processes only become, what we say, successful when we chant Hare Krishna. Because it's the Yuga Dharma. It's the Yuga Dharma. It's been given special preference in this age for purification and for, what we say, glorification. And so I said, well, you can't really force her, but you should continue to encourage her to try to chant. And if she doesn't, I said, I'll guarantee she won't stay in that service. She'll leave. So he said, all right. We didn't want to do anything to discourage her, but always encourage her. So we tried to encourage her in so many ways to chant in a very nice way, explaining how important it is. But she never decided to take it seriously. And one day, without any notice, she gave up her service. Because Krishna, who's there in the deity form, she's trying to serve him, is saying, chant my name. You want to worship me? Well, okay, you can do this, but without chanting my holy name, you can't please my pure devotee who's asking you to chant my holy name. Therefore, without pleasing my pure devotee, you can't get my mercy. You can't approach Krishna without approaching Krishna through his pure devotee. And so the pure devotee is saying, chant Hare Krishna. So, therefore, she wasn't able to maintain that service because Krishna kicked her out. We didn't do anything to encourage her to leave, to force her to leave. We just tried to encourage her, but Krishna said, you're not qualified to do this worship unless you chant Krishna mantra. So this is the position of the holy name of the Lord. Well, what is that chanting that makes chanting actually chanting? So I was just recently listening to a little 5-minute discussion. Mostly Prabhupada was speaking to Satsrup Maharaj. And this was in 1973. In July, Prabhupada was in London. It was July 16th, I think, or 17th. It's a 5-minute discussion. Prabhupada's talking about our process. And how to engage in our process. And then he begins talking about the holy name. And he starts saying, we should chant the holy name. Not like shu 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 shu. So sometimes we find ourselves in a hurry or enthusiastically wanting to do something else and wanting to finish our vows. So this is not the way to chant the holy name. The holy name has to be given complete attention and reverence and not in the mood of trying to finish. Therefore, once you get, and Prabhupada said, once you chant, he actually puts it in the Chaitanya Charitamrita in one verse. Actually, it's Adi Leela, chapter 17, verse 32. In the purport, Prabhupada said, once you chant clearly, using the upper and lower lip and avoiding the hissing sound. Hare Krishna. Krishna. Krishna, 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 Krishna. Krishna, we're not in a hurry to finish. We're in a hurry to try to chant with the best possible intention and nice pronunciation. So, therefore, take your time and chant nice. You can see, or you can hear, on Srila Prabhupada's japa tape, when he begins the tape, he chants very methodically and very carefully. And as he chanting, he's increasing his speed. This is the secret of chanting. Hear nicely at the beginning, absorb yourself in that sound, and your speed will increase through the quality of your hearing. Chant with devotion, chant with attention. Not, here's a joke. I'm going to say this sometimes. This is kind of funny, but it actually has some. There's one person, he's chanting. Snicker, 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 room, 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 snicker, 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 room, 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 snicker, 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 room. And he dies. And he comes back in his next verse, and he's there in a strange land. He's looking around, and he sees these two men. And one of them comes up to him. And he says, "Who are you?" He said, "My name is Snicka, and this is Ruby. You've been chanting our names." So, I mean, Krishna knows who he is. So when you're chanting the holy name, even if it's not in perfection, Krishna is, you know, what is it? He, Janardana, who's that? Grahi Janardana. Bhava Grahi Janardana. Okay, Bhava Grahi Janardana. I mean, he takes the essence rather than the expression. But don't use that as an excuse. Prabhupada, if we want to please Prabhupada, we have to chant nicely. Krishna's a little bit more merciful. If you chant his name, he'll accept it. But because his pure devotee is not allowing us to chant like that, he won't accept it. He wants to please his pure devotee. So his pure devotee says we should chant his name clearly, with devotion, with attention. So focus on that. Make that your life and style. And as you perfect the chanting of the holy names of the Lord, you'll see everything else in your life will also become nice. Because it's the foundation for everything. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that if you want to somehow or other make a difference in your spiritual life, he says this is where you focus. Focus on attentive chanting. This will expand out into everything you do in your life. So, this is the qualification to make advancement in spiritual life. We want to chant. And by chanting nicely, with intention and devotion, we develop a taste. And as the taste develops, then the enthusiasm for chanting also increases, you know, proportionally. So Prabhupada makes one statement. He said, when you're actually chanting the holy names of the Lord, you'll think 16 rounds. Why not 16,000? In other words, it becomes sweet. And the sweetness, it inspires us to want to taste something, to taste the sweetness over and over again. So Krishna's name is very sweet, but we have to approach it in the proper way. I know we live in a world where we have a lot of responsibilities, taking care of children, taking care of our household, taking care of our occupations. So we sometimes find ourselves squeezing in the rounds. But I have a formula for that. If you have sufficient time to chant, then chant accordingly, nicely, and try to hear. If you don't have sufficient time to chant, whatever time you do, say you have 1 hour, you say, I'm not going to try to get as many rounds as I can in this 1 hour. I'm going to try to chant as nicely as I can in this time. As opposed to quantity, quality. And then, whatever element, you can set some more time aside throughout the day. Early as possible, of course. And do it again with quality according to the time allotted. And that way you'll find happiness in chanting and not just trying to finish the rounds. You don't get very much from chanting if you're simply trying to race through it or if we're inattention. You should very carefully try to hear. Even in kirtan, when we hear, when we're performing kirtan, it's kirtan and japa is the same thing, only it's done in congregation, everyone. Individual prayer. In kirtan, we listen very carefully and we also respond. And try to hear the sound of your own voice when you respond in kirtan. And the holy name is very powerful. It will take your consciousness into it. But in the initial stages, we need to make a very strong effort to hear nicely. By hearing nicely and chanting with devotion, what does that mean to chant with devotion? It seems like it's a little nebulous or a little unclear. What does it mean to chant with devotion? It means to realize you're helpless. You are helpless. And we need the mercy of Krishna. We need the mercy of Krishna's holy name. So chant with that mood of helplessness, calling out for Krishna's mercy, praying for Krishna's mercy. Offer prayers before you chant in order to invoke the mercy of the great souls, that Lord Krishna. This also helps to bring about quality in our chanting. What is that? Why does that bring about? It shows our sincerity. We really want to perfect our chanting. We really want to go deeper into the chapter of the Lord. And from this part, this is, as Prabhupada said, this is the foundation for everything. In other words, he would also say 95%, 99%, he said different numbers within the 90 range. All is your advancement in Krishna consciousness based on your chanting. So that's the essence. But Krishna says here, one who is chanting my glories and doing it with determination is, and then offering me respects within their hearts and minds, it's a great soul. He doesn't say a great soul is one who knows the Shastras so well, or one who can smile and attract everybody else by their smile. He doesn't say that. He doesn't give any external or material, obviously, definition to great soul. One who is always glorifying me, that's a great soul. Now, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati qualifies the essence of chanting by saying, and Srila Prabhupada has also repeated it in so many different ways, is that we should accompany the chanting of the holy name with the hearing of Krishna's pastimes. Hearing of Krishna's pastimes. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes, Ram's pastimes. We should chant the holy names and also develop an attraction or a regular process of hearing about the glories of the Lord. And that way, these two things together are complete in the process of glorification of the Lord, because they each enhance the other. And when we get a taste for hearing and chanting Krishna's pastimes are so sweet and so very deep also, that we can also, develop our chanting through that also. That helps to chant more and more. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati makes a nice statement where the holy name must be accompanied by the hearing of the pastimes of the Lord. As Krishna is always accompanied by Srimati Radharani, this internal energy. And he makes that analogy to Radha Krishna and Krishna Kapha and Krishna Kirtana. So this verse is describing what is a great soul. Everyone is a great soul in the sense that everyone is pure, has a pure loving relationship with Krishna. And that makes the person a great soul. But that has to be, what we say, experienced through the process of hearing and chanting the glories of God with determination. This word determination is the foundation for the practice of the Krishna consciousness. Maya will give you so many things to be determined about. And so we have to see how to access that same mood of determination in our spiritual practice. To hear and chant regularly. This is the roots, this is the nourishment for everything we do. We should not mistakenly think that the holy name is not related to everything else. It is everything else. There is nothing but the holy name. The Shastras say there's only two things in this world, the jiva and the holy name. That's it. Everything else is an expansion of those two things, the living entity and the holy name. And to add a little bit of a flavor to this discussion, I can give you a special secret.
Do you like secrets?
A secret is something that in spiritual circles, a secret is something you speak, but you can't understand it until you practice it. If you tell a person a secret, then they know it. That's a material way. But in a spiritual way, everything is revealed through the shastras, but you can't understand it. It's a secret. It remains a secret until you actually realize it. And then you realize it through the practice. So the special secret is chant the rounds early. And that, Prabhupada also mentions that many times, that early rounds are the foundation for success in the process of chanting. Because the early morning hours are conducive to hearing and chanting nicely, the mind is free from the encumbrances of the activities throughout the day. And by chanting early, the mind becomes fixed in activities throughout the day. The holy name gives clarification and also gives direction throughout the rest of the day. If we don't chant early, we'll find ourselves struggling. We say 16 rounds every day, but really, when you really get into the essence of this chanting, it's early rounds. And Prabhupada qualifies that even more. He says, if you haven't chanted your 16 rounds, you should know that at any moment you could be victimized by Maya. You could be victimized by Maya. Why? Because that vow that we have given, for those of us who are initiated, that vow secures the mercy of the spiritual master. He says, when Prabhupada was asked, what is your most important instruction, Srila Prabhupada? He said, my most important instruction is for my devotees every day to chant 16 rounds on these without fail. We were waiting for something really colossal, like, I don't know, my most important instruction is to spread the teachings of Krishna consciousness around the world, or something. But he said no, he's talking about individual development, which is the foundation for collective development, expansion. There's this chanting rounds every day, 16 rounds, on these without. And then he qualifies it early. So these are some of the things we can remember in the glories of the holy name. And if you make the holy name first, Krishna will make you first. The holy name will make you first. Whatever we have in life, as we prioritize our life, that becomes the most important thing to us. And we keep Krishna first, we chanting his holy name. The holy name will reveal Krishna throughout our life. Hare Krishna, Hare
Krishna, 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 Hare Hare.
And then one actually becomes, in action, a great soul. So everyone's a great soul, but some are realized and some are not. Any questions?
Yeah, also, we gathered on this conversation. We have between the body and the miraculous and the last. And he's been explaining that one chapter, opening the chapter, is not set up like the Bhagavad-Gita script. He's explaining that to the sannyasi, the non-bhakti sannyasi, that he said that you can't change, and so you can't change perfectly in the beginning. So you should change a lot. And then it's given to you as a gift. Each advancement you made is a gift given to you because someone who has the relationship with Ryan is basically advocating for you to give you mercy. Mm-hmm. But you have to show dedication, and it's like a practice, like such as an Olympic athlete, to get better as they do it. But I'm confused because I always hear you gotta chant a good round. You gotta chant, try to chant perfect rounds. But it's kind of like saying, Bobby Malone said, you can't do it. It has to be given to you as a gift. So keep running with
it. What is that gift giving that he's talking about? The question was, well, chant perfect rounds, but we can't chant perfect rounds. So what is that perfection that comes by way of getting the gift? Is your sincerity, your determination. Your effort brings about Krishna's mercy, but your effort alone will not be able to reach perfection. Only when Krishna is pleased by your attempt to chant his rounds nicely with devotion, then Krishna will give you that gift through his representative. But he's given us the process to chant, and he's given us the means by which we should practice the process. And therefore, we follow that to the best of our ability, and Krishna does the rest, and he reveals himself in that way.
And I always ask...
Does that make sense?
Yes. Since I was a kid, I always asked myself about... I always thought about this, because when Bhakti Siddhanta received initiation from Lord God's Bhakti, the first instruction was to not say anything until you chant this amazing amount of rounds. Then you can talk, then you can speak. And that always fascinated me.
You have to do an instruction. Don't talk. We usually don't say much anyway, it's not important. Especially the first thing you get up in the morning, you should always remain. The first thing you get up in the morning is you pay your obeisances to your spiritual master and you chant the name of the deity you are serving. Sri Sri Radha, Shakti Radha, Jiniki Jaya, you offer your obeisances to your spiritual master and your Prabhupada. And then you remain silent, or you can chant within your heart and mind as you're performing your bodily needs, and then you, when you get to your beach, you don't speak all kinds of stuff in the meantime while you're all doing that. It just disturbs the mind, and when you want to sit down and chant, it's not so easy. That's why the morning hours are very conducive to chanting. Therefore, remaining silent with all other activities on the side is conducive to chanting. We used to do that all the time. We would never talk to each other living in the ashram until we were done with our hours. We would all bathe in silence, we would take care of our bodily dress, everything was in silence. But internally we were told to chant prayers, to chant the Panchatattva mantra. You're preparing the mind to sit down and hear the voice of the Lord. The mind at that time can be easily disturbed. And if you speak too much about other things, or just things in general, you'll find that when you sit down it becomes hard to focus. The mind's in a special, it's kind of unencumbered that time, so don't put anything in it to encumber it. Mostly free from the activities of the previous day. There may be some thoughts there, but you push them aside and just focus on Krishna's will. Or say suitable prayers. It's like sometimes we... I recommend for those who live at home in Grihasthas that they may not be able to have a morning program, so they can chant while they're getting ready, they're chanting Guru Vastika prayers, chant the Tulsi prayers, chant the Guru Vandana prayers, chant the Holy Name. Do that with your family members out there. If you can't do it all, just do at least do the Guru Vastika. We call them the samsara prayers, but that's not the name of them. It's not the prayers of birth and death. It's the Guru Vastika. We worship the Guru at the beginning of our day, which opens up the process of chanting the Holy Name. That's nice. You can do that at home, even if you're not living in the temple. So this is practical. But the thing is, if we really want to perfect our chanting, we have to follow the entire process of Krishna consciousness. You can't just follow it. You can say, I'll chant Hare Krishna, and then the rest of the day I'll speak all kinds of nonsense. It doesn't work. You're preparing your consciousness by doing other things to support those qualities that are conducive to approaching the whole range of the world. Anyone can chant, but to actually perfect our chanting, we also have to perfect those qualities that are conducive to our chanting, such as humility, tolerance, patience, righteousness. Those things that Krishna mentions in the Bhagavad-Gita, which are qualities of the Vaishnavas. These are fundamental to actually approaching the whole world. In the beginning, you can always approach the Holy Name in any situation. But after some time, it's recommended that in order to continue and to progress in the chanting, one has to cultivate the mode of goodness. And those qualities that are conducive to the mode of goodness. So Prabhupada would say, the Holy Name is the means for purification, but it's part of the process. It is the process. But it's also related to everything else we do. Or everything else we do is related to the Holy Name. So he says, if you're not following the process of Krishna consciousness, the chanting of the Holy Name is like trying to cook with smoke. You ever try that? Ladies, those of you who like to cook, no fire, maybe a little spark there, a lot of smoke. Put the pot underneath, almost like 300 years for breakfast. So in other words, the process has to be followed along with the chanting of the Holy Name, because that supports the chanting of the Holy Name. What is the process? Yes, that every day, hear Srimad Bhagavatam. We should, if we live in a household, we should worship the Lord in His deity form. Prabhupada says, if devotees who live outside, who are initiated, who are living outside, must worship the deity in the home. He says, if you don't, you're falling down in Krishna consciousness is guaranteed. It's this exact statement. It's from that same verse by Prahlad Maharaj in the nine process of devotional service when he talks about deity worship. But Grihasthas must worship the deity. That is their dharma along with chanting the Holy Names of the Lord. So all these things are part of the process, but the process is to purify our heart through chanting Hare Krishna. So it's interesting. You'll find the shastras are very apparently contradictory. They speak about no rules, and then they speak about all rules. It's really according to time, place, circumstance, and candidate. You know, for a person who's just new in Krishna consciousness, you say, just chant. We don't give them a lot of rules and regulations at the beginning until they actually get established in the chanting. Then they start to learn that in order to progress in their Krishna consciousness, there's certain things they have to follow along with the chanting. No meat eating, no illicit sex, no intoxication, no gambling. They support, or if not followed, can take away from a chanting. The shastras say, initiation is not required. One can simply chant the holy names of the Lord to reach perfection simply by chanting. The holy name is independent of initiations mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So why does the spiritual masters emphatically say we must get initiation? Because in this age, no one can chant the holy names of the Lord without proper guidance in spiritual practice, because the age of Kali is so bad. Therefore, one has to have guidance in order to stay on the path of bhakti. Therefore, one has to take initiation in order to progress in the performance of chanting. So, unless you have a spiritual master to give you clarifications on the Shastras. The Shastras, you can go into any part of the Shastra and find whatever you like and use it as an opportunity to practice accordingly. Guru is the walking Shastra. What is that verse from the... Where's our, who's our Pandit here? Pandit. Okay. What is that verse from the Mahabharata? What is that verse from? What's the first one? What's the first one? Tarko Pratishtha, Sakitavadi Vindam. What's the next one?
Naiko Rishirasya Vachanam Pramana.
Mahajano Yena Katas Sipanta. This is a very instructive verse. That there are so many sadhus, there are so many scriptures, and they all give different. So how can one understand what is the truth of the spiritual practice? Mahajano Yena Katas. The truth of religious scripture. It's hidden in the hearts of the self-realized soul. They know the process, so one has to take shelter of a pure devotee and follow. And then one can get one can realize the Shastra through the Guru's direction and guidance. One cannot do it by themselves, or without the mercy of the Guru. So that's the process. When you were giving that example from Jayavadana, that person was qualified to give that instruction because he was on the level of a spiritual master. And he told him, just chant. Right? Anything else? Any other comments? Any questions?
Sometimes I hear devotees who live close to the temple say, I really can't come for the temple program because I have to do my deity worship at home and I don't have enough time to do it. And I remember hearing someone say before that when you're living in the area of a temple that Radha Charity Hari is the group of deities for all of us in the as for hostels, and that that should take precedence over our home deity worship if there's has to be a choice?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have to acknowledge that there are persons who are living outside who can't always come to the temple every day. Now, the temple is here. The temple is a place for worship. And we should consider, if we live in the community, we should be Haraji. We should consider our deity as an expansion of them. So we can worship our deity, if we have Radha Krishna, or Gurudatta, as an expansion of the altar deities also. But we should also come to the temple occasionally. It's not like I only stay home, because I may have some responsibility. But if you have to see whether it's an excuse, or it's a real, actual statement of fact that I can't always come. So, it's not like every, the grihasthas can come every day. It's just they have family responsibilities. But they have to be honest. When they do have time, they should make time to come to the temple, associate with devotees, get the Mahaprasad with the deities, which is very, very powerful. It's very important to get the Mahaprasad of the Lord from the deities. Very, very purifying. And take part in the festivals like Rathi Yatra, Jadmasthani, Sunday program like that. And take an active part in the temple in one way or another by supporting the temple or coming in sometimes and offering a little seva whenever you can. That's one part. But to come every day, I think that would be unreasonable to demand. That's my understanding. Anybody want to add to that? Different question.
Well, the Gihastas, the Gihastas, they have duty at the house. And they do ashram every day. But suppose for a week, 10 days they are going from home, how they are supposed to take care of the deity?
They have their duties at their home and they're worshiping every night, and
yeah. So suppose they're going somewhere for 7 days or 10 days.
Oh. Well, that's a good question for...
May I just add to that? That is the reason I don't have a deity at home, because I travel often, and sometimes I'll go for 4 days, sometimes 2 weeks, 3 weeks, so I can't...
Yeah.
So I empathize with the doctor.
Yeah, and using your example is important. So, in your case, you should also see if this taking instructions and guidance from someone who's in the position of a spiritual master, explaining your situation like that. It may be different from person to person, but if you make that evaluation on your own without getting guidance, you may not be exactly the best. Therefore, that's why we get practical instructions along with philosophical teachings, to see how we can practically apply that knowledge. So, we should get advice. Now, I know there are certain persons who put the deities to rest, and others carry the deities with them. It depends on the deities, whether it's going to tie or Ravana Vishnu. So, I've heard different things in different situations, but if you really want to get the knowledge clarified, you approach a spiritual master or someone who's in that position and find out according to your situation what you should do in that. I don't think that could be used as a general instruction, because circumstances are different from person to person. Yes, what did you?
I do have a disease worship in my home, but in the United States. The same disease moved from India. According to the temple and we have a temple in India also. So they told me whenever I'm going to my home, or if I'm going for travel for 3-4 days, or going for a month. So whenever I leave or whenever I come back, I got initiation also. I talked to my Maharaj also about all right?
Okay, so whatever he says, that's perfect.
Yeah, so it's not very difficult because it's just in mind. People think it's very difficult to be worshiping home and come to temple. Or I believe is if you have a desire to do in home or come to temple, it's your desire. When you have a desire and you make efforts, it will come true and you will be able to make it.
Yeah, that's true. But you also have to consider how much worship you want to do. Some people can do it very simple, and some maybe much more. So.
Depend on your strength, depend on your physical.
Yeah, and your like that. Your time and your also your spiritual attraction.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. Good point. Thank you.
I was away for 4 months in India, but I do have Radha Krishna ladies at home, mm-hmm. other things. But I do it in a very simplistic way. I don't do a lot of rituals, a lot of pujas, even though I know some Sanskrit verses and all my father taught me. Still, I consider Krishna and Radharani as my friend. When I say Krishna is everywhere, when I do manasika prayer, then he receives everything. Whatever. Even when I go to India, I offer the same thing to him. He can receive from anywhere. So I don't have to take it to anybody and obligate someone to do my things, what I'm supposed to do. It's a relationship between me and Krishna.
Yeah.
So it doesn't. Nobody has to be involved in that.
Right.
So Krishna is everywhere, anyway. When in your thinking, you can reach him too. Whatever you offer, Sarvam Krishnatma. So you offer everything wherever you are, whatever you do. So this is the way you can.
That's on the strength of your own devotion. Everyone has that. You know, that realization or that strength of practice. If you have that, then yeah, that's there. That's why the instructions may be different from person to person. And also, how to worship also should be in accordance with Shastra. According to Thai worship, is very simple. Radha Krishna requires a little more, Jagannath a little bit more than to go to Thai. So. Yeah.
I don't want to complicate everything, so make it simple.
No, make it simple, but make it with devotion. Krishna is accepting the devotion. Home worship can be done accordingly. And according to what means you have to do it, what time you have, and the level of your own spiritual practice. I know some people who worship at home for hours. Hours. They do more worship at home than the temple does for the deities here. And they're good at it. But if you ask someone else to do that much, they'll be able to do it. So that's why the guidance of a spiritual master and how to perform the worship is very fundamental. But deity worship is two things. Keep it simple, keep it clean. Keep it on time. Yes?
Maharaj, I asked this question. There were devotees in India. They were in Radha Krishna Gurdwara. And the disciple of Radha Krishna. And you were listening to my lecture of Maharaj. And Maharaj mentioned about Ghanshyam Das Babaji.
Which Babaji?
Ghanshyam Das Babaji.
Ghanshyam.
So Maharaj mentioned, and Maharaj, he was really, for him, Maharaj was very dear, and he was very dear to Maharaj. And he had Radha Krishna, he was staying in somebody else's house in a lobby, you know, outside lobby, Varanda.
Ganesham Baba is on the spontaneous devotional platform.
So 60 years he served, and he didn't go even Varsana and Varanda, in 60 years. He had that much love. Now this devotee says, I can't go anywhere. I told you, don't try to compare yourself with Ghanshyam Das Babaji. But he's telling that his village is that, no, I'm not going anywhere. I'm rather not going to die. And every day, this devotee is doing the
meeting. He's realized that in his service to Radha Krishna, everything is there.
Yeah, so.
He doesn't look for anything else. He's completely satisfied and he's worshipping with pure love.
Yeah, three times he cooks. Rajrog, evening, morning, cake, pizza, everything. I mean, very nicely, you said.
Love cannot be legislated.
But in
It's spontaneous. When you get to the love platform, then the rules and regulations take a second stance. But until you're on that